Well, welcome to USA Volleyball and the U.S. Olympic Committee's Where Olympic Journeys Begin. Great Q&A, great coach session, this time with our new gold medal coach of the first ever world championship team for females, Karch Kiraly. We're waiting for Karch to come on, and when he does, I'll let everybody know, although I think he'll come on verbally. This is a prepared PowerPoint with questions for him, which he received earlier, and then it turns into a chance to go live with questions and answers from him. But the reason we're starting here at 10:36 is because of what I'm going to put up back on the screen. At 10:36 p.m. on the 12th of October, the 62-year drought finally ended. I guess that's a form of what Jeremy's talking about, Hebrews 10:36, about perseverance, those that follow the Bible. We've got several people from around the world joining us as well. And I don't know if any of those 12,600 people beyond Karch are in the stands. We'd love to hear from you as well. So we're just waiting for Karch to come on board. He had said that he would be done by 10 with his training that he was doing with some athletes, and so just not sure where he is. In fact, we don't even need him to be on to go through the stuff, although I think he just joined us. And that's a good sign. Karch, welcome to the show. Are you out there?
I don't know if anybody can hear me. I'm not sure I'm hearing anything.
We can hear you fine. Can you hear us?
Hello, John. Are you there?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
I can. We can.
Okay. It sounds like we're good. I was having a little technology trouble, but...
No way.
We are ready to go.
All right. Well, thanks a ton. I was just getting ready to go through the beginning of the slides, which is just a review of what you've done. And that's, part of the fun for sure. All the photos, by the way, that we've got in this recording of this webinar come from the FIVB or USAV. So we'd like to thank them. And I think... you're holding a pretty solid trophy. Isn't that a replica trophy? Didn't somebody steal the trophy in Brazil on its tour, and they had to replace it suddenly for your event?
That, the trophy was making its way around the world in some pre-event publicity. We took it to Hawaii with us as we were on the second half of our USA Cup, our USA Cup exhibition series with Brazil, and then eventually it made its way to Brazil and somehow got stolen during weekend two or preliminary week two of Grand Prix. So I don't know where the first one is. That might be the second edition. Who knows?
Yeah. Well, your full name, not everybody knows, because everybody knows you as a single word, Karch, but Charles Frederick, is that sort of a family history? I mean, if your dad is Laszlo, so I'm not quite sure where Charles Frederick comes from.
I was born Charles Frederick. Frederick is in honor of my mom's brother, Uncle Fred. But so many people got so confused by that I'm now Charles Karch, and so that has changed a while back. That's the real name. It just got to be too difficult in documentation and things like that, and passports and banks and all that stuff.
Gotcha. everybody that's watching this live sees this. Everybody that's going to be watching this as a recording can pause on this. As a younger player, both collegiately and the Pac Rim events, you did some pretty remarkable things early on, running a 6-2. I remember... Al Skates once said that they do the 5-1 defense with you. Five people go where they're supposed to go, and then one person digs it, named Karch, something like that, which is kind of about reading. So we'll get into that. Some pretty remarkable accomplishments as an indoor player, for sure. And, you know, some of these things like youngest player on the team and some amazing stats for sure that everybody can look at because we want to get to Q&A time. On the beach side, you know, I think the bottom line I highlighted because, you know, winning a tournament in 24 of the 27 seasons you played over four decades, that's pretty remarkable longevity. And there will be some questions about beach and indoor training coming up, I know. So you've got a pretty good beach guy to talk to. People talk about karching and, you know, your arms up, raised. you know, you've been doing it for a while, obviously. And we are honored to have you on today. Now, so I have a question, a personal question as we get started. Do you know who you beat in this $5,000 purse Pro-Am tournament in Boulder, Colorado? Among others, because you won the darn thing, as I recall. But do you have any that poster? You were 17 or so.
I do not, but I remember having a blast up there in that event. That's one of the few early events that was held outside the state of California. So Sinjin and I headed up there late in the season.
Well, you beat me and Bobby Clark, I'm sorry to say, in the semis. I was quite disappointed to lose to that.
So, as Bill Murray would say in Caddyshack, so I got that going for me, which is nice.
So how many trading cards have you been on? These are two that I happen to have from Sports Illustrated for Kids and on my shelf of Foot Locker back in the, I guess that was Superstar days, I'm assuming. I don't even know what the heck that Foot Locker photo is about.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Wow, that is digging back. I wish I could tell you. I tend to be occupy the end of the spectrum that is looking forward to the next challenge and not looking back at the last one, so I really couldn't tell you about the cards.
All right, cool. So you became an assistant coach. This talk is not really about you as a player. It's about your victory and what you've learned as a coach to pass on to other coaches. And, you know, Karch, Hugh chose you to make that jump because of what, you know, he saw as an invaluable role. So one of the first questions is that people are asking, why did you choose to start coaching indoor and not beach? And what's the hardest thing about transitioning from player to coach?
Well, first of all, you know, thanks to Hugh for taking a chance on me. It is taking a chance on to hire as a member of your staff, somebody who's had a lot of success on the athletic side of things and not a lot of experience on the coaching side of things. And I know I fight every day. The norm is that people who've had lots of success as players don't have lots of success as coaches. So I'm fighting against that norm. Lots of times people who've had a lot of success make assumptions or just think, well, that should be easy. You know, you just do this. And they don't get the teaching side of it. So I'm just trying to be a better teacher tomorrow than I am today. And I was also fortunate because of the chance that Hugh gave me. He decided after Beijing to switch after he had coached the men to a gold medal. He decided to try to do the same with the women. And that created an opening with USA Volleyball on the men's side, and I'm sure they talked to a zillion people in an effort to try to fill that vacancy on the men's side. And one of the many people that they talked to was me. and I considered it, but didn't feel like that would be fair to the program or anybody else, the team or me. I just didn't feel like I was experienced enough and ready enough to do that. So, and one of the people I consulted with in that decision was Hugh, and so just through a chance set of circumstances, it came about that that he asked me to be a member of his staff, and it gave me the opportunity to accumulate a lot more experience and feel like I would be in a much better position to do justice to the position after a few years in that spot, a few years of learning and experience. And so the natural opportunity came up to coach indoors. Originally, why I got started, and that was a few years before that, was because our boys, who hadn't played a lot of volleyball till they got to high school, decided to play. And one of our boys was playing for his team, and he was a ninth grader, and our older boy Christian, and they had a really tough season that year. They had a lot of young guys who were raw, but had some real potential, and they ended up losing not just every match, but every game of every match, every set of every match. So they went something like 0-93 that season, and it was a tough one to watch as a parent cheering them on. We just wanted them to get one set victory. I think one of them, they were up 20-10 and didn't quite be, we thought, all right, finally they're going to get to 25 before somebody else, but they lost 25-23. So I asked the school if I could help out. My wife, Janet, just said, oh, you've got to help those guys. All we want to do is see if they could get at least a set, maybe not a match, but some sets here and there. And so it was a really fulfilling experience because they worked very hard. And got to the first match of the next season when now both our boys, the ninth grader Corey and 10th grader at that time Christian, were on the team, and they won the first set of the first match of the next season and went nuts like they had just won the national championship. So it was a really cool moment, and then of course I had to calm them down a lot and let them know, you know what, if you can win one of those, you can win three of those. And so they got better and better, and over the course of 4 years they went on to eventually win a Southern California championship title. So that was kind of the start for me.
So did you get offers, or do you even still go back and do some beach consulting at all? Or are you too busy for beach right now? And
I'm too busy for beach right now. Even while I was coaching our boys at St. Margaret's High School, St. Margaret's Episcopal School in San Juan in South Orange County, I was still very busy playing on the beach tour. And then when I stopped playing on the beach tour, I essentially just I was coaching with Hugh. And so I had a couple of more seasons of coaching both with Hugh and the women, and also coaching the boys' high school team till our younger boy finished, till our younger son Corey finished up.
Wow, you're doing double duty.
Yeah. And with all that, no time to do any work on the beach.
Right. So what has been the hardest about transitioning from a player to the coach? Can you pin one thing down and answer that question?
I think the biggest lessons I always learn are in just when I make assumptions. I guess a good example of that, and it was a good lesson for me, but maybe also for other members of our staff. We were well into the first season of 2009, and when we scout other teams, we talk about what they do in certain rotations, rotation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and of course, we got to make sure to remind our players in May and June, we're talking about American rotation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, because the rest of the world numbers them in a different way based on what zone of those six zones on the court the setter is in. And so we were in the middle of talking about some of that stuff partway through Grand Prix, and eventually I figured out that we figured out that some of our players did not know what rotation two was, and we were making a big assumption that everybody knew what rotation two was, that it meant that the setter was in middle back, and that the opposite, usually in a 5-1 offense, the opposite would be in middle front and so forth. So we made a huge assumption that everybody knew that. We were working on that assumption, and it meant that we weren't being as effective as teachers verifying what it was the learners knew and making assumptions about what they knew. We've got lots of great learners in this program, and as soon as we identified that there was a deficit, within about a day or two, we corrected it by teaching it a little better and actually learning some things in the process. We taught everybody how to identify rotation 1 through 6, and it was interesting for me because I'm more of an outside hitter background or a setter background, and it was interesting to hear some middle blockers talk about how they identify certain rotations. They look at the opposing middle and see where they're standing. Setters might look at where the setter's standing, and outside hitters might look where the outside hitter's standing. So we learned lots of good ways as a group through this process of how to identify rotation 2 very quickly, and then, of course, put our plan into action. But if you don't know what rotation 2 is, it's going to be pretty hard to implement a plan for it.
Excellent, excellent observation. So in your role as an assistant coach for those 4 years, a lot of assistant coaches are going to be listening to this. So what advice do you have about being the best assistant coach you can be?
I think in some ways, having now been a head coach, I would be a better assistant now than I was when I was an assistant. It's just there's a better understanding of what is needed in different phases of this program and this job. So I think it actually really helps to have worn lots of hats and fulfilled lots of roles. But I guess the best thing, advice-wise, is to check in, and I could have been better at this too, but to, as I'm learning and being better, to check in with your head coach and just say, what do you need more of from me? What do you need less of from me? Here's what I see as my responsibilities, as what you need from me, but I may be way off. Tell me if I'm way off. Just tell me what I need to do to be good for you. I don't think there's any one answer, because different head coaches want different things from different assistants in their program, and it might be that a head coach in one program looks for very different things from a first assistant than a head coach in another program might. So it's very individualized, and mostly it's just making no assumptions and asking lots of questions and trying to get lots of clarity so that everybody understands what's needed. And when you figure out what's needed, that's about 85% of what you need to do to be good for your boss, for your head coach.
Thanks. Let's talk family here a little bit. How have your parents and your own family helped you in your journey? Is there any advice now that you've been doing this through, you know, for 20 years, 30 years, plus being a son for 50 plus years?
Well, there's no way I could do perform this beast of a job that I enjoy a lot, but it demands a lot, without my best friend and this absolutely amazing person that I met and eventually married, my wife Jana, and our two boys, Corey and Christian. And so it was great to have, for example, my wife and my folks, you see them in the photos there, and my mother-in-law, they were all there cheering us on in Italy during the World Championships, and it was awesome to have some friendly faces and to have their support for them to do the little things that allow me to be as good as I can be, or to try to be as good as I can be in this job. My dad, of course, gave me my start in volleyball at the age of 6. We started playing pepper back and forth, just forearm passing, bumping the ball back and forth. And he's been a, you know, he was my first coach in that sense, my first teammate. We played together for the first 4 years of my competitive career on the beach from when I was 11 to when I was 15. My mom was there cheering us on the whole way, and they came to many of the competitions that we played, that I, my teams played at various levels, high school, college, USA. Went to Argentina for the World Championships in 1982. Of course, went to the Olympics in 84, 88, and 96, and lots of other competitions along the way. So, and the same thing for my wife, Jana. She's, and our boys, they've been to actually every Olympics since 1996, the three of them, because, of course, before then, in 92, our boys, I wasn't involved in that Olympics, and our boys were very, very young at that time. Right. So we've got a nice streak of Olympics going for all of them. And the next thing to do is to try to get through the arduous qualification process for Rio and try to make some plans to get them all to Rio to be some lonely cheering voices there amongst lots of very enthusiastic and passionate Brazilians who will be cheering their team on.
Yeah, to say the least. Thanks. You know, 1036 is why was when we started this webinar, because that's when this 62-year drought ended. Thanks to your program and the athletes on the court. What changes did you make from your Grand Prix finish, which was not that far behind, you know, too far back, to what you did in Italy? Was there anything that you changed to succeed?
We had a disappointing Grand Prix. We would have liked to finish much better. We and a lot of it, the difficulties we created for ourselves were in weekend one, where we lost to Russia after winning the first set, lost to Turkey, and then took five sets to beat Japan. And so we only came out of there with a paltry 3 points out of a possible 9 that we could have carried. We spent the rest of Grand Prix trying to dig ourselves out of that hole, didn't quite succeed. But one of the things that we learned was how much our serving was, I guess, was at a level that was below what we needed, far below our standard. We weren't serving in enough. We weren't hitting the right person or the space around the right person enough. And we weren't hitting serves that were getting people in trouble enough generally. And so huge props and hats off to some people on our team. We just basically told the jump spinners, you're going to set that serve aside. It's not working as well as it could for us. The best serve in international volleyball is a jump float. We had some jump spinners. We had Nicole Fawcett. We had Jordan Larson Burbach. We had Kelly Murphy, and we had Kelsey Robinson. And they all have sometimes very effective jump spins, other times less so. Huge hats off to them, because they all embraced the fact that when we came back, we said, look, we're going to spend a couple of weeks here with everybody jump floating. Nobody is spinning here, and we're going to develop a second serve if we need it. And it turned out to go so well for them that Jordan served at an astronomical rate, Nicole Fawcett the same, Murph improved hers, Kelsey improved hers, and so we were a vastly improved serving team by the time we got to World Championships. We served in at 93% instead of at about 86-87% on Grand Prix. That was a big upgrade, but more importantly, or just as at least as importantly, is that those serves that went in were often, much more often, going to the right space around the right person on the court. You just can't control where you put the ball as much with a jump spin. And so all in all, it helped us score points at a much improved rate. Even though we were getting the ball in a lot more, we were serving people out of system percentage-wise a lot more, so we bumped both those categories up. And it went right down to the last play, where people who were not known as our most effective servers, Christa Harmato and Kelly Murphy, three of their last five serves, Christa served four of them and Murph served the last one. Three of the last five got China out of system and created scoring opportunities for us, including the very last one that was a vicious jump float. If you look at it from the end zone view, our scouting view, it started to Murph's left and then it veered radically to her right and the libero for China could barely touch it. And that created a down ball situation for us, which created a scoring opportunity, which Kim Hill put to the floor. So, and the other benefit to actually, or we made it a benefit because that was our only choice, was, all right, we had a disappointing Grand Prix, but what it meant is we got an extra week of training and an extra week to work on some of these things, including our footwork as pin hitters, including our serving, our jump float serving, and some big upgrades happened thanks to that extra week. So we made the best of a disappointing situation, and it put us in a better position to have a nice result in World Championships.
Well, as we go on to that, just because of the Grand Prix, we wanted to make sure everybody listening to this knows about the fact that the finals are going to be in Omaha, Nebraska. Any thoughts about hosting it? Because that puts you in the event no matter what, if I'm not mistaken.
It does. And this, except for the Olympics, this is going to be the biggest event, USA, biggest international volleyball event USA will ever have hosted. I don't think the U.S., I could be wrong, but from what I know, the USA has never hosted Grand Prix Finals Week. And the USA has never hosted World League Finals Week. Those are the biggest annual events on the women's side, the men's side. Of course, USA has hosted three volleyball Olympics. Two, you know, in 84 and 96. But it has never hosted a World Cup or a World Championships. And so we're super excited about the opportunity to play in Omaha, Nebraska. That's one of the two huge focal points for us next year. The other, of course, is just 4 weeks later, and that is the biggest event of 2015. It happens every 4 years. It's the second of the three majors that come in the next 3 years, World Championships this year, World Cup next year, which is the first Olympic qualifier, and then, of course, the Olympics in 2016. So two big opportunities for us. Grand Prix, including Finals Week on our own soil, which we're already guaranteed to be in since we're hosting, and then the World Cup in Japan a month later, starting August 22nd. The top two teams at the World Cup, which is less than previous World Cups, but only the top two, not the top three, earn an automatic berth to the Rio Olympic Games. We'd like to have a nice result there and see if we can book a berth.
Fantastic. The event in Italy and the men's event in Poland had some incredible fans, and as well as just a wonderful arena. There's a panorama shot of this picture that you can just look at 360 degrees on the FIV website that I'll share with everybody attending this webinar and put it up. But it brought to light a question from a coach. Our coach is saying, you know, when you have these big events that you have to qualify for, World Cup or Grand Prix, that are in your season, just how do you do the things to get ready for it? And specifically, a few coaches were asking about, from a state high school playoff point of view, and regionals and all the stuff that they go through, what do you guys do to help overcome anxiety in the athletes, if you do anything at all?
We do a lot. We talk about the mental side of this game a ton, and the mindset, and the approach that we take to it. So one big thing that we have done right from the start is that every time we put a USA uniform on, and we do that a lot, most weeks that we're home training, we play on Friday nights. We're kind of jealous of what high schools and colleges get to do. They get to train a lot of the week, and then they get to play and see what learning took place, what learning sticks, what more work needs to be done, and acclimate to playing in front of a crowd with our colors on. And so every match that we put a uniform on is a gold medal match, a championship match. So by the time we got to the semifinals in the World Championships against Brazil, that was gold medal match number 82 of this Olympic cycle that goes from the end of one Olympics to the end of the next. And so up to all of our players and staff have done it already up to 82 times by, or 81 times by the time we set, we stepped out on the court against Brazil. And then we've done it up to 82 times by the time we did it the next night. So our approach is exactly the same. And we emphasize that that's what we need for our best performance. You've written here, big events. Well, they're all big. And when they're all big, they're all the same. And we just take the same approach. We don't build one match any bigger than any other match we play. And that helped our whole program acclimate to playing deep into this tournament and playing tougher and tougher opponents. But we took the same approach as we would the very first time we put a uniform on back in May when we played a USA Red Blue on a Friday night in Santa Barbara, California on, I'm looking at my wall calendar here, on May 16th. Of this year. So we have a ton of acclimation, and that I think was a big part of why, even though we had 14 players all told at the World Championships, only five of them had experience of any sort in a World Championships, in a World Cup, in an Olympics, but all of them were great about the way they approached it and handled it. There is no big event. They're all big. And when they're all big, they're all the same, and they all just become, yep, here's another championship match.
What a great lesson for everybody. Thanks, Karch, and to the, your program for that. That's fantastic. To the people that haven't had a chance to the HP, come to the HP clinic, it's coming up in February. Some great coaches, including Karch. Velasco is going to be there. I can't remember, somebody else is coming in from Spain or something like that. But I have no doubt that Bill Neville, who's in this picture with you, this is the dining hall at the Olympic Training Center where the best stuff really starts happening, because you're interacting with each other during meal hours, morning, noon, and night, as part of this course. And you can go to the USAV website and click on high performance and sign up if you haven't had a chance to do that. Space is limited. With that, this is a picture of you playing, I think, in the 84 games, and you're blocking yourself. That's what's actually happening here, as Coach Neville teaches you how to do that. So that's our high performance suggestion for people that really want to get to be better learners and teachers of the sport. The question that came to this was, how much physical training do you expect of the USA women? That's essentially the way the coaches are asking that. And you, if you want to talk periodization, fine, but I know that there's a lot of questions about the physical training that the athletes are going through.
They do a good amount. We have a great strength and conditioning coach, Tim Hilo, who is actually works with a number of teams. He works with the USA men, the USA women, plenty of beach athletes on both the men's and women's sides, and also women's water polo. One of the things that we have to keep in mind that's very different from lots of other people who might be considering this question is that our athletes play a ridiculous schedule. It is brutal, mentally and physically, on them. They play far more than they should when they have this combination of really leading two lives. They play with USA and represent our country as superbly as they did in this last tournament, And they're with us from May through the end of September, middle of October. And then they get, most of our players got a grand total of 6 or 7 days off, some even less than that. And then they become professional club players. And so literally, the night we won in Italy, we got to go back with Doug Beal, CEO of USA Volleyball, and our staff and our players, and take a sip of champagne and make some toasts. And that, it was about 1:30 at night by that time. At 4:30, we congregated in the lobby, and everybody met to, you know, jumped on the bus and headed to all parts of the world. Nicole Fawcett flew straight to Korea to join her club team. Some people went home for a few days to see their families in various parts of the USA, and then went off to where everybody's playing, France, Germany, Switzerland, Italy, Turkey, Azerbaijan, Russia, China, Korea, Japan, Brazil, and lots of other places. And so they play these two seasons, and it keeps them going almost continuously. So that's a long explanation of why we have to be really careful with our training. We have to be very careful about not overtraining people, because they're playing 50 weeks out of the year already. So a lot of the approach in terms of strength and conditioning and so forth is just trying to keep people healthy and get them a little stronger to stay healthier. It's and so we don't get that many lifting days, and it's certainly not about going crazy with conditioning stuff. We don't have a preseason. We can't grind them into the ground with double days. We would never think of such a thing. That would be insanity with this program. And we let our work on the court do most of the work of conditioning. Playing the game teaches the game. Playing the game gets you in the best shape for the game.
Fantastic. You know, you're a pretty busy guy, and you're taking time out to help us grow the game through this webinar. And I got to say again, I appreciate your time to do this, because I know you're so busy. I want to take you back to a time you came to Colorado Springs and were with us here. You wrote about it, but I'd like the audience to just sort of hear what you do to give back to the sport, as they see in this photo alone. Are these photos?
Where's the one with my my fuzzy pink hat? That's the one I'm looking. I think on the lower right there, I might see it, but it's on somebody else.
Yeah, she's so got it. I'll send it to you.
I remember having a good time with my fuzzy pink hat. Well, there are tons of people who work their tails off to try to infect people around this country, especially, and around the world, but especially in this country, with our love and our passion for this game. So I tell team regularly, and I fess up to it. I'm not embarrassed about it. I am a total volley dork, and I get goosebumps all the time from things that people would probably think are pretty corny, like a beautiful forearm pass off a nice, off a really good jump float serve when somebody's been working on something, and then they put it into action and they make it happen. Off a challenging play from across the net. Just all the things that people call little that are not little to me. They're never little, especially when you don't do them well. They're big when you do them well, and they're huge when you don't do them well. So I'm just one of thousands of people out there who work really hard at trying to share our love for this game and infect young people with it. Like, you see all the cool young girls mostly, and some young boys too, who are in this photo that I think was from a couple of years ago. It was awesome. You could see upper right, they made some they took some sidewalk chalk and made some nice signs for me in the parking lot there, and it was just, it was a really fun event. And those, it makes it easy for us when people do the nice job that, like you guys did, of just building up and letting people know. Some USA people are going to come over and talk to you, and they're excited about this game, and hopefully they'll infect you with a little of that excitement.
Thank you. So volley dork, huh? How does a volley dork get better when not in the gym?
By being a learner, by not being afraid to ask questions, by not being embarrassed by making mistakes. The number one job for our players, job number one, is to be a learner, to have, as Carol Dweck has so well described in her book, Mindset, to have a growth mindset and not a fixed mindset. And I guess a good example of that is if you're afraid of making mistakes, if you're afraid of jumping in and getting your feet wet and getting your hands dirty, and you're embarrassed if you make mistakes in front of others, it's going to really slow down, and you force yourself, you hold yourself back from taking risks. You really hold yourself back. We each hold ourselves back as learners. I guess a good example of that is that any of you know, and some of you probably are this person, but anybody that you know who has picked up a second language, it has to be a learner. And one of the hallmarks of learning a second language is that you're not afraid to try it. If you're afraid to try it, you're never going to learn it. When I went to play in Italy, and I only played for two club seasons there, I carried a dictionary around with me everywhere, a translation dictionary, an English to Italian, Italian to English dictionary. I asked my teammates, because I just wanted to learn Italian. I wanted to be a better teammate. I wanted to help my team better and enhance my, and make just a better, deeper experience in my 2 years there. And so I got a simple book on Italian from, I think it was from the University of Washington student bookstore, just a basic workbook. And I was even laughing about it just a couple of weeks ago. We were back in Ravenna, and one of my teammates from then, he said, you know, Karch, you used to ask me questions about grammar, and you'd say, you know, like, why does this word end this way, or why does this and that? And he said, every time you used to walk around me, I used to start sweating because I had no idea what you were going to ask me, and I had no idea of the answer. I'd have to call my aunt because she's an Italian teacher just to get you the right answers. So, so I was trying stuff, and I have some, you know, funny moments where I said completely the wrong thing. I probably told somebody to, you know, to go, I don't know, screw themselves by total accident. And you just, when you jump in and you make mistakes, you learn from them. But if you're afraid to, you're never going to pick up that language. And it's the same with learning anything else. If you're afraid to make mistakes, you're just holding yourself back. We all are. If I'm afraid to make mistakes, I'm going to be holding myself back. So we have to be models of that for our athletes. If we ask them to be learners, we got to be learners in front of their very eyes. And we've got to be willing to try new stuff and tell them, hey, we're trying something new today. It might not work out. That's okay. We're going to learn. We're going to learn another method, as Thomas Edison puts it, or put it, I think. You know, if an expert is somebody who's made 10,000 mistakes in 10,000 different ways and just figured out yet another way that doesn't work before you find the way that does. And that's what we have to do. So we got to be models for that. And that's the number one thing that is going to make each of us better as a coach, both in the gym and outside of the gym, in terms of our relationships with our athletes, in terms of our communication, in terms of being on a continual learning process. Just this last weekend, I was up at up in Colorado Springs in a pilot program for the USOC. A number of national team level coaches are taking part in this continuing coach education program. So I want to be better. I need to be better. If I'm asking that of our athletes, then the least I can do is do the same.
Well said, as always. You're probably a good learnerado, or adding ADO to everything so that you can speak Spanish there in Southern California, right?
There we go.
So history is something that not a lot of kids know. Using this photo, is there any way that you might suggest getting our athletes to know about everyone, you know, our sports history? Because they hardly know the national team players as we speak, even with the great success that has been going on.
I think a good part of it is probably just telling stories and relaying lessons that you might know of from players in the past. I probably could do a better job of it with our own team. But I guess an example was, it was 5, 6, 7 years ago, something like that. I got, just kind of through a friend of a friend of a friend on the beach tour, I got hooked up with a woman who coached high school volleyball in the Cleveland area. And she wrote this nice note to me. She said, "Hey, I was running practice with our team, and one of our players did something nice." And I said, "Whoa, good job. That's something that Karch would have done." And so, of course, the player said, "What's a Karch?" And she said, "Oh my gosh, you mean you don't know Karch?" And every player said, "Well, of course we don't. What's a Karch?" And so she stopped practice for a few minutes and told them a little of my history. And it's not just about me. There's a whole generation of people like Paula Weishoff, Debbie Green, Rita Crockett, Flo Hyman, and the people who came before them and the came after them. So this doesn't apply just to me, but to lots of people who've come before as athletes. And so she told them about the nice career I'd had as an indoor player and was in the midst of still on the beach. Or maybe she just told them about the indoor career. And so the next question was, "Whoa, he sounds like he was pretty good. Like, is he still alive?" So it just led to a comical series of questions, but it was really cool because I had an appearance in Cleveland just about 3 weeks after I received this letter. And as I approached the trip, I reached out and found out a way to reach her. And so I stopped by and got to say hello to the team and show them the gold medals of the teams that I was lucky enough to be a part of. And so we kind of closed the loop on that, and it was really cool. But, you just got to, I guess, dive in and make it a part of the regular conversation.
So tell us who's in this photo. Give us a history lesson for those that don't recognize the three other people, perhaps.
Well, to the left, of course, is our 1984 and also 2000 and 2004 USA men's national team coach, and coached the 84 Olympics, which we won in Los Angeles, and the Sydney Olympics and the Athens Olympics. And in fact, that's the succession, because after Hugh coached in Athens, his assistant was Hugh McCutcheon. Hugh McCutcheon took over for the next 4 years and led the men to the gold medal in Beijing, and then switched over and coached the women to the silver in London. And next to Doug is a great friend of mine and one of our band of 12 who competed in the 1984 Olympic Games, Paul Sunderland, who has gone on to a long and successful career as a broadcaster, as a play-by-play broadcaster, not just in volleyball, but for many different sports. But if you watched the volleyball from Poland, the men's world championship, or from Italy, the women's world championship, Paul was the voice of the final rounds of each of those tournaments. And in fact, he was, I think, working by himself. So he was not only play-by-play, but he was analyst. He was playing dual roles as a single person behind the microphone. And then to Paul's right, between him and me, is one of the all-time great players of indoor volleyball, Alexander Savin, who was just an absolute stud of a middle blocker for what used to be known as the Soviet Union. I hadn't seen him in many, many years. And he showed up down on the floor after the finals was over and after the medal ceremony was over. So it was great to see him. And then Paul and Doug were around, so we congregated for this shot here. But I remember when I was in high school, my buddies and I used to subscribe to Volleyball Monthly and Volleyball Magazine. And there was no volleyball on television. There was no internet. There was no way to see live what we dreamed about. But we would see these pictures of people like Alexander Savin. And when he was blocking, he would get up so high that his arms were horizontal. They were parallel with the ground, and he would just reach way over the net. And we would envision and imagine trying to hit around that block of his and his teammates. And he and his teammates were the very best team in the world from 1977. They lost in the Olympic finals in 1976 to a great Poland team that had players like Tomasz Wojtowicz on it. They got really started a big move toward incorporating the back row attack a lot more. And so then the year after in 1977, the Russians were the best team in the world from 77 till about 84 or so when we took over. And so we idolized them, we emulated them, we dreamed of competing against them, and eventually some of us got to do so.
Thank you. The bottom question, you know, do you have any suggestions about using the gold medal success that you just achieved with a woman to help volleyball in the USA forward? Do you have any thoughts or suggestions?
Well, one of the secondary focal points of mine when I took this job over in September of 2012, September of 2 years ago, just a month, less than a month after the end of the Olympic Games in London, was and I know the women's side well, I don't know the men's side as well, but I look at the women's program and I think, gosh, there are all of these amazing, powerful, intelligent, dedicated, hardworking, articulate women out there who dedicate their lives to making this program and this team great and dedicate their lives to being great themselves. There are all these wonderful role models for young women and for young men, for girls and boys who are a part of this program, but they are essentially almost unknown in this country. There's a huge junior population, probably close to a quarter of a million people, young girls who play club volleyball from probably, you know, around 12 to 18 years old. There is a big high school population. I think, John, you know the numbers better than I, but maybe it's around 550,000 people, and very few of them know who Christa Harmato Dietzen is, or who Jordan Larson-Burbach is, or who Faluka Akinradoo is, and I could go on naming names all down the list. And so I just think that is a situation that we'll call it less than optimal. And so, but I also know that the challenge is that USA, by virtue of our schedule, first of all, those athletes, as I mentioned before, are gone out of our country because we don't have a pro league here, so they're gone a lot of the year. There's no way people could know about what they're doing. And then when they come back and they play USA, most of our competitions take us right back out of the country. If we don't have any forum, if we don't have any platform, any program in the USA, as I'm looking out my window of my office and waving to Christa right now, she just finished a workout and she's working on getting herself to the optimum level of health here. But so if we don't have any kind of program, how are we supposed to expect people to know what we're doing? So that one of my first conversations, just out of sheer happenstance, was with a great guy and a friend and a supporter of volleyball named Craig Thompson, who was on Team USA and involved in the 1984 Olympics and done tons and tons in many different arenas in the world of sports, and just said, you know, Craig, we got to figure out a way to play on U.S. soil some and get the word out about people. So he got involved with the program, and he and his company, Mindspring, are the official marketing arm of USA Volleyball, and they made it possible for us to bring, along with USA Volleyball making it possible for us to bring Japan in a year and a half ago, or a little less than a year and a half ago, and play a series in Southern California, and then bring Brazil this past July to play two versions of the USA Cup. And slowly but surely, we're going to host more competitions here, and that's a big way to get the word out. When I was on the team, we didn't go to play. We weren't allowed to go play in club volleyball or in professional club volleyball around the world. We were with the team 50 weeks a year, and we played lots of barnstorming tours around the country. We'd bring the Soviet Union in and play them on the West Coast, or bring Cuba in and playing them on the East Coast, and just we'd play tour after tour. Most of our things were tours, not tournaments. It's the opposite now. But it allowed people to touch and feel and see a little part of us. And so that's one of the things that we're trying to do and we'll continue to try and do. We're working on the next iteration, the next team to be brought in to play the USA Cup next year. And so those are some of the things that we're doing to try to build the visibility and the popularity of this game, is we have to have stuff on U.S. soil. We mentioned earlier we get Grand Prix Finals weekend. Omaha, Nebraska. That'll be great. We're also going to bring a team in for USA Cup. Those things over time are what those platforms are what allow us to make that connection better between the top of the pyramid, the national team, and the big bottom of the pyramid, the 250,000 or so girls who play club volleyball.
All right. Excellent. So I think I know the answer to this next question, but it is one that a lot of people ask, and I thought it gave us a chance to show the Yugomobile. That
probably... Jeez, you are digging deep back into the archives with that picture. That is classic.
Most people don't even know why there's a volleyball, USA Volleyball logo and the word Yugo next to it. But do you have any superstitions or, and again, these are fun questions from the coaches, pre-competition rituals, more specifically as a coach, that you do or teach your players?
I played for lots of coaches who were not big on rah-rah, pump people up, emotional, super passionate, fiery pregame speeches. Our players, I think, they have enough adrenaline already because they're playing a gold medal match every time they have their a uniform on. They don't need me to get them over, I guess what we would call over-activated. We talk about it with our high-performance psychologist, our high-performance sports psych, Mike Gervais, that we've worked with for these last two seasons, and he's done a lot of really good work with our athletes and with this program. He also happens to work with the Seattle Seahawks and with Red Bull and lots of other high-performance programs. But we talk about it regularly, that if you're essentially dead or catatonic, you're at a zero level of activation, and if you're about to have a heart attack because your heart is racing so fast, then you are at a 10 on the activation scale. But we want to be somewhere right in the middle. We want to be at about a 5 or a 6. And different people are going to have, that's going to mean different things for them. But we don't want to be jacked up out of their minds, out of our minds. When we get overly activated, we can't do the things and have the fine motor control that we need to do to make the good plays that we need made for this team to be great. So it's a pretty calm. Our team has rituals that they do. They play lots of music in the locker room before I step in and talk for a couple of minutes, and then they talk together on their own, and I'm sure they each have their own things that they do to get ready. Superstition, one of the things I did to try to fight superstition was my superstition was to do it a different way every single time. So I didn't have the same things that I did all the time before any game or competition as a player. That, I guess, would have been my superstition, is to fight superstition and do it a different way. But ultimately, the reason we do superstitions or we have superstitions or we have rituals are the fact that this thing's scary. It's scary to go lay it out on the line and risk losing. I admire people who do it over and over and over again, and people who are in our USA program do it. So I admire our athletes. It's scary for a couple of big reasons. Number one, you and your team can do everything right and still lose there's a chance that could happen. It doesn't happen very often, but we could do everything right and still lose. And the other big and scary, or maybe still two other big and scary things are about it, is, or maybe a corollary to that, is that we don't ultimately have full control over over the scoreboard, over making it finish our way and turning it into a W instead of an L, a win instead of a loss, a victory instead of a defeat. And that's scary, that we don't have control. So we try to control things by having these elaborate rituals and superstitions to make it go our way. We don't have full control over our performance. We don't always perform at the level we want to. And then finally, the other reason it's pretty scary is that losing, the emotional difference between winning and losing is great. Losing hurts. It stings. It cuts deep. And winning feels great. And so we go through these rituals and these superstitions to try to exert or at least fool ourselves into thinking that we have more control over the situation than we really do. But ultimately, the best way to have control over the situation is to forget about the scoreboard and to just focus on what it is that we need to do, not to win the next point, because if we can't guarantee winning the match, then we also know we can't guarantee winning the next point. If we did, we'd win every match 25-0, three straight sets, three straight games. But all we can do really is maximize our chances of winning the next play. And if we do that over and over consistently, then we do exert more control over the thing that we care about a lot, and that is the scoreboard.
Fantastic, again. So best advice as a, from a coach or a teacher, and I was going to add in best advice to you as a, from a player perhaps. Anything comes to mind. I love this picture of Marv Dunphy, who helped you as well. Not only in 88 when you won the gold medal, but helped you win this gold medal 20 some odd years later.
Be a learner. So the best advice I think I ever got was just don't be afraid to make mistakes. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to look stupid. When we're in a group setting, a lot of times some people might think of good questions to ask, but they're afraid to ask them because they're afraid that it'll be a stupid question or they'll look stupid asking it, when instead, usually the ones that people think are the dumbest questions are the best questions. And so we try to encourage our people in our program to ask questions. They don't ask as many as we would like them to. They're still a little inhibited by the fact that they don't want to ask in front of a group. But we say, look, if you're afraid to ask in front of a group, send me a text. Ask, if you want to know why we're doing something, we'd love to answer that question. I always bought in much better as a player if I understood why we were doing stuff than if we were doing stuff and there was no visible rationale for what we did. So I can't even remember who said it, and really because it's not any one person. Lots of people have told me that. I hope that I never stop learning until my heart, until the old ticker gives out. But this has to be a continual learning, a continual improvement process. And if you're not afraid to make mistakes in front of your team, I think you're going to be a lot better coach. You could say, hey, we tried it. It didn't work. I'm learning here. Sorry. It's okay to apologize and I think the people who are more secure in their ability to learn and be good coaches are the ones who are going to be more open with their team and be more willing to fess up and laugh at themselves or just fess up when they've made a mistake and acknowledge it and make it okay to make mistakes, make it okay for the whole program to make mistakes.
As you said that little vignette for just a moment, I thought I was in a timeout huddle over the last two or three years with you, just hearing that same, not the voice inflection that you have when you talk to your kid, the athletes in timeouts. But tell us more about your advice in a timeout, because I think you're pretty consistent there, but it's almost unusual compared to many coaches.
Well, my wife describes it well when she watches some other coaches out there who have a look of frustration or exasperation or kind of a frowny face or rolling eyes or raising their hands like the way she, my wife Jana puts it, lots of coaches out there make it, the way their body language is and what they do are exhibiting or screaming out the statement, what are these stupid women doing screwing up my perfect plan? And I just don't think that's the best way to get the best performance out of a group of women or out of a group of men or out of a group of anybody on any team. So I'm not an eye roller, and I'm not a put your arms out in how, you know, how dare you, how could you do that? What are you doing? And sending that signal. I have a lot of trust and belief. I have total trust and belief in this group that I'm so fortunate and blessed to work with. Group of athletes, group of coaches, got an amazing staff. And so I guess the other thing I put together with that is that I played for, I'm very fortunate to have played for some of the best coaches I could possibly have imagined. People like Rick Olmsted at Santa Barbara High School, Al Skates at UCLA, Doug Beal, Marv Dunphy, Bill Neville, and the list goes on. But all of them, especially when I got to UCLA and beyond, it was not about berating us on what was going wrong. We all know what's going wrong, so let's we don't need to dwell on what it is we're not we're doing wrong. Let's dwell on what we're going to do right, starting right now. And so I like the rhythm of our timeouts. We're just focusing on something simple to do on the next play. Acknowledging that other teams are going to make great plays, other teams are going to make series of great plays, and we'll get our chance too. They're going to make runs at us, we're going to make runs at them. That's just part of the back and forth and the yin and yang of playing against an opponent that is so good that the outcome is in doubt. If we wanted to, as Mike Gervais has said before, you know, he's asked our team, so do you guys want to win every match you ever play from this day forward? I have a way to do it for you if you want to guarantee that you win every match from this day forward. Fortunately, nobody raised their hand, and he said, well, good, but if anybody has had raised their hand, here's how we do it. We'll just go play fourth grade teams from now on. And I think people would get pretty bored with that very quickly. So we want to play where the outcome is in doubt, and it means that people are going to put together stretches of really good volleyball against us. That's all right. This is adversity. Nobody wins a big tournament like that without facing down this major adversity. And then the other part of the rhythm of the timeouts is that our assistant, Jamie Morrison, you see Marv there, but Jamie's in the background. We can't see his head in the photo that you have here. But Jamie is our master planner in terms of planning our defense. So we, in an effort to focus on the positive and focus on what we're going to do next in a positive action in a positive way, we almost always finish our timeouts with me turning it over to Jamie, and he will then say, you know, after we win the next play, we get somebody new to the service line. And when they go to the service line, a USA player is serving, we have to have a plan for how we're going to score that next point. We know what the other team, what rotation they'll be in, what they're likely to run. And so it's, again, a way to focus. And I do it like a broken record sometimes, so I probably do it too much sometimes. Maybe people get a little sick of it, but that's my approach is that we're focusing on what we're going to do next in a positive way, and Al Skates was a master at that. He's not the only one, but he was a master at that in terms of instilling us with the confidence to move forward no matter how bad things might have looked or no matter how good things might look. We always looked forward and we always focused on what we were going to do to maximize our chances of winning the next point.
Excellent. And now you brought back memories of when I played in Italy where, you know, you're desperate for a volleyball magazine, and now the internet and YouTube and everything has brought some amazing stuff forward. So the question for you is, how has technology impacted your coaching and practice and in the match?
Technology is an ever-growing part of what we do, with the fact that we record every training session. We call them rehearsals as opposed to practice, but we record every one of them so we can go back and review and try to learn and get better. And along with recording, we often, not always, but often have our technical coordinator, Joe Trinzi, who does a fabulous job for us, also sitting in the end line, as you would have seen him at every match we played in Italy at the World Championships, where he's typing away madly at a computer and putting in thousands and thousands of keystrokes in a 1.5 to 2 hours or 2 hours plus match that are tags that are associating every action we can possibly associate on the court with a tag and a time code, so that we can go back. And if you were playing John, we could pull up every time you passed in zone 5, or every time you attacked a go set, or every time you were defending and the other team was attacking from the back row. We have lots of different ways we can slice and dice things to quickly pull up within just a few minutes of the end of a practice or the end of a match, the end of a rehearsal or the end of a match, and look back and look at it on an individual and on a team basis. So that's an example of a technology that's been around a while, but eventually I know that that's going to be thought of as Joe says, that's going to be thought of as, we're going to laugh at a time when we think of Joe typing away madly at his keyboard. Eventually, it's going to be a series of cameras, as they already have in lots of NBA facilities, a series of cameras, fixed cameras mounted around the venue that that just do visual recognition, and it's all computerized and it's all artificial intelligence, so that nobody's going to have to type in anything. It'll just recognize who's touching the ball at this instant and what they're doing, and it'll do all the coding for us. So we'll laugh at in 10 or 20 years or less at the time when somebody like Joe was coding away like a fiend at the keyboard. That'll be something that'll certainly come along in the near future. We use a lot of TiVo stuff in our rehearsals, where we have a quick delay set with using iPads and other things, where somebody might forearm serve receive a ball and then step off and look at it because it's on a 10-second delay, and then step back on and step back off and just to try to get lots of visual feedback. Super slow-mo cameras. There's lots of things that we haven't even thought of, but that's some of the technology that we use, and it's affecting the coaching and the match maintenance a little, or the match management a little, because technology is getting better, and now they're bringing instant replay into the world of international volleyball. I know in Italy, in the men's league, this past season, in the pro season, they didn't even have linesmen. They just have cameras along all four lines, and if there's any close call that the referee or the second referee doesn't get right, the team has a right to just ask for a quick lines review, and they get the call right. Eventually, they'll have review for not only lines, but touches off the block, touches on the net, violations of the service line, of the 3-meter line, of the of the center line and anything else that we can think of. Did the ball touch the ground when somebody dove and laid it out and put a pancake and tried to put it under the ball? All of those things. So it's making the game better because we don't want the referees are human. They're trying to do the best, make the best calls they can. We're trying to be the best we can, but it's taken some of the mistakes out of the game from a referee standpoint and letting the players decide the game more. So that's a good thing too.
Yeah, it brought back sort of sleepless nights, memories of doing rotational tapes and stuff with VHS that now
What a mess that was. Take 8 or 9 hours to make one simple little side out tape, and now we can have it ready in 3 minutes. You want to see rotation one of us against Russia from this match? Here we go. Pull it up right now.
Oh, true. So music is a part of your program's success, I would have to say. Care to share the observations on music and this great photo of everybody on the stand?
It absolutely is a part of our program. Music is one of the proven through studies, one of the proven mood elevators. But the reason I started thinking about music was just because we know there's a state-dependent aspect to learning. And if you're trying to learn and be better when the whistle blows and you're on the court, which is in the photo of this picture that you have displayed, where that podium is actually on the court that we played on. They put the podium there and the carpets and dumped all the shiny gold confetti, but that is the court. When you're on the court and the whistle blows, it so happens that we're trying to make it as much like that court in our own gym as possible to have the maximum amount of transfer. And part of it is this state-dependent thing. So we know that at international matches, they play music before we compete. There is always warm-up music as a part of almost any volleyball match that I know, especially at least, maybe not so much in club, but certainly at the international level and the interscholastic level at college and high school. Lots of warm-up music gets played. So I figured, why not play warm-up music before our rehearsals? If we're going to play more warm-up music before our matches, it'll also just acclimate us to the process. And it's been a great thing for our program. So we played warm-up music all the time before every rehearsal at home and on the road. And our players are in charge of the playlists for that. We have nothing to do with it. They get to decide what to do, except if it gets just a little too raunchy in terms of the lyrics. We might have to put our foot down a little bit, but rarely have we had to do that. Or if it gets a little too raunchy in the sense of there are some lyrics out there that talk about just women in a really denigrating way, and of course I don't want that kind of stuff in our gym either. But beyond that, music is a great thing. It's awesome, and it's also good because, and this was just kind of a side benefit that we learned to it, but when we take a long trip and we travel 8,000 miles from Turkey to Brazil, and we're zonked, and we go to the hotel, and we dump our luggage, and we throw our stuff on, and then we go to training an hour later, and we're on a different time zone. We're all pretty beat, but then we get together, and we put our arms in the middle, our hands in the middle, and we talk about what we're going to do, and we say USA, and then we start playing that music. It's like it's time for work. I don't care how I'm feeling right now. This is the time when we are getting better, we're learning, and we're getting ready. We're trying to master our craft, and we're trying to get ready to play Russia or Korea or Brazil in 2 days. And so it's really a good way to lock us in to this spot. Another way I've heard it described was by the explorer, the undersea explorer Robert Ballard, who was a part of the group that eventually found the Titanic after it had been gone undiscovered for many, many years. And he said, you know, when you're floating around on that ocean and you're in the middle of the ocean, you could be anywhere. You are not only literally adrift, but you're mentally adrift also. There's no spot to relate to. There's no point where you that's different than any other that has any special meaning. But then when you get to that spot and they finally found the Titanic and they got to that GPS position, it was like they just locked in and they knew exactly where they were. And there's a beauty in that. And so that music helps us with that aspect.
Fantastic. How are you doing on time? Are you okay?
I am okay. We've gone a long time, so I don't know if people have gotten a chance to ask questions.
But well, we're getting close to that.
Yours.
You're going to be here in about 3 months talking. What would you like to share with coaches maybe considering coming?
We like coming up there. We learn because we get asked questions, and it makes us think in a new way. So the best thing for me about it is the learning aspect, not any teaching aspect, but just the fact that we make an active attempt, not just attempt, but we actively interact, mingle with lots of the coaches who are there. So you mentioned it before, and Julio Velasco, one of the international coaches of volleyball who has had lots of success with the Italy men, I think with Argentina and with the Iranian men and other people. And the other coach who will be there is Henri Tilly, who did a great job coaching his French team all the way to the semis and barely lost to, I think, Brazil in the men's world championships in Poland. His son plays on the team, Kevin Tilly, who had a great career at UC Irvine, mostly playing for John Sparrow. And then also, why am I drawing a blank on John Sparrow's successor? I know I should. I'll think of it at some point here. That's horrendous of me not to remember his name right now. But anyway, there's lots of good minds there to pick at. And so we sit with different people at breakfast and at lunch and at dinner, and we're volley dorks. We talk volley. We love to talk volley. We love to figure out ways, better ways to do this thing.
David Tiffin.
There we go, Tiff. It's Niffin. And David's doing a great job with that UCI program and led them to a great victory his first year taking over. And, of course, it's still one of the preeminent programs. So, yeah, Niff. And what's cool about Niff is he actually took a year to coach with Kevin Hambly at Illinois when they had a great run. And almost won the NCAA championship. My Bruins won it instead that year with Mike Seeley, but Niff, it was cool. He made the crossover and did some things in women's volleyball, then back to men's, and he brought somebody from Illinois back, one of the rare women's coaches, Michelle, and I'm drawing a blank on her name, but she was one of his assistants there, brought from the Illinois program, and it was also cool to have her involved, a female coach involved in the men's program.
You know, you're known for your reading capabilities, and I don't mean sitting on a chair and reading the newspaper, but your capabilities of the hinky, as you've spoken about it, some conventions and things like that. Any observations on where your program is now and how you're teaching reading and how that assisted you to the gold medal?
I also remembered the name that I forgot there. It was Michelle Bartsch. So she was coaching with Illinois, and now I think she's playing overseas. So reading. You got to do it a lot. You got to see the game a lot. And you talk about this all the time. And so, you know, it's Our huge, huge challenge in the gym, in rehearsal or practice or training or whatever you want to call it, is every minute, how do we make the most of the minutes that we spend there? Transfer. How do we make them count from what we do when we're training to what we do when we're playing, when we're actually competing? Because as one of my favorite coaches and teachers always says, we don't drill volleyball. We play volleyball. We compete at volleyball. And so we got to figure out ways to make it transfer. And lots of the science, all the science tells us that the way to make it transfer is that you make it look more like a game when you're doing it in practice. If it doesn't look like a game, if it's a coach on a box the whole time, or a coach serving, or a coach hand tossing, hand feeding the ball to people to start the play, there's not going to be as much transfer. And if I get a little more transfer in my gym than you do in yours, over time that's going to build up to a significant advantage. So why not do that? And so we got to give our players lots of chances to see live stuff and to see what they're going to see in the game, see live hitters meeting a live ball in midair, see when they get their feet to the ball there, when they don't, and make the adjustments as a blocker and defender. If we're just doing everything off a toss and all of that, then we're robbing our players of chances to see thousands and thousands of times and build the ability to, or slowly accumulate what I call kind of a visual encyclopedia. And so you see, because at the start of every play, anything is possible, but then each fraction of a second that elapses, it starts narrowing down, funneling down the possibilities until another second or two in, and you get to narrow it down. Okay, it's probably either going to be this or this. You kind of flip through your mental file cabinet, your mental encyclopedia, and you get to narrow it down to the greatest possibilities and just play the percentages. But we have to give our players lots and lots of chances to do that. If we don't, then they're not learning to read fast enough. They're going to be learning slower than the other team.
And I think if listeners here type in Hinky and Border Patrol or U.S. Border Patrol, they'll probably be able to see some interesting articles on that topic that you've spoken about as well.
Yep, Hinky is a term I originally learned from an article on the Border Patrol, and the gist of the article was when you're learning, when you're standing there waving car after car across the border in Tijuana, Mexico, or El Paso, Texas, at first you have no clue what you're doing. And or if you're, I guess another example would be a fireman, and you're just learning, and you walk into a situation where there is a fire taking part, you just don't have the experience of seeing hundreds or thousands of situations. But slowly over time, you develop this with experience, and with seeing lots and lots of these, you develop this. It's like a sixth sense. It's another sense. You can't even put words to it, but that's okay because it's a visual thing. It's a visual and a perceptual thing. It's not a word thing. But after seeing 9 or 10,000 cars come by, you start getting the sense that something is off about a particular car crossing the border. Maybe it's riding a little lower. Maybe it's riding a little unevenly, like there's more weight in the right back corner where somebody might be hiding in the fender area in some special container that's been built to smuggle human cargo. Maybe the driver is sweating a little more than he should, or maybe he's looking in a different place than he should. Lots of times these border agents can't even really tell you exactly what it is, but they can just say, nope, there's something a little fishy, a little hinky about that car. And it's the same thing with being a fireman. Something doesn't feel right. Get your people out of there before the whole thing collapses. Firemen with lots of experience have this sense. They can't even really tell you what they saw, what they smelled, what they felt in terms of the heat. But something was off, and they get people out. And something's off on the volleyball court when a hitter doesn't get her feet to the ball, when a setter puts one on, and she's in the front row, and she puts her left hand up, and her right hand drops. The hinky comes out big time. It means that she's not going to set the ball. She's going to put it over on two. She's going to jam it. She's going to jump it, dump it. She's going to do something else. So we have to see those situations a lot to learn to identify the hinky, the fishy, but we call it hinky in our gym. We have a lot of volley dork terms in our gym that I think most of the time our players laugh at me rather than with me when we use them, but that's okay. If they're laughing, hopefully they're having some fun too.
Jeff Stevens shares the, we call that our spidey senses, our spider senses.
That's a very good way to describe it too. You can't necessarily say exactly what you saw, and that's okay. Sometimes you can, and that's okay too, but it takes too long to verbalize it. But most importantly, we just have to identify it. It's all on pattern recognition and knowing what the usual pattern is, and then knowing what the unusual, the hinky, the fishy, the spidey pattern is, the unusual pattern. And we have to identify that, and then we can make very good plays that are a lot easier to make than the regular plays. When somebody tips a ball as an attacker, if we make the read, if our spidey sense picks it up, then it's just so much easier to turn that into a point than a really hard-driven ball from somebody like outside hitter number two from China, or outside hitter number 15 or number 11 for Russia, some people who are big and just hit the crap out of the ball.
Yeah. So in your gym, the term punishment has been asked by many coaches. What are your thoughts about punishment, physical or otherwise?
I like the way Marv describes it, first of all, and I think he heard it from John Wooden, because Marv did his doctorate on John Wooden and his teaching and coaching methods, so Marv is very, very familiar with one of the greatest coaches who's ever been a part of the sporting world, and that is that discipline is not something you do to someone, it's something you do for someone. And so we don't really have punishment per se, but if we didn't go for a ball, or if we didn't do something, if we didn't exert effort on a play, then we just, I guess we call it what my great friend Tom Pestalozzi, who's been in the coaching world forever and does a wonderful job at Irvine Valley College, he calls them OTIs, opportunities to improve. So it's not a punishment. It's just like, hey, if you didn't go for that ball, you three people, that's just not what we do. USA is not about standing around and letting a ball drop. So I'm going to give you an opportunity to improve, and I'll throw a few balls around the gym, and we'll chase after them, and then it's back to work. Or if we hit out down the sideline when we said we do not, we must hit inbounds along the sideline, along the near sideline. We must give ourselves a cushion. We don't aim for the line. We aim 2 or 3 feet into the line. And then if we hit out, okay, well, I'll give you a few tosses, and you'll hit a few in, and you get an opportunity to improve, an OTI, an opportunity to correct, an OTC, and then we get back to work. So it's not a punishment at all. It's just holding people accountable, holding the high standard that we must hold for this program to do what it wants to do, to make the history that it aspires to make. And then, of course, we just have small consequences also for winning and losing. So it's not very much, but it might be, running and diving or sprawling to three different lines if you and I are on a team and we lost that given drill. So maybe the consequence for losing, along with the fact that it stings a little to lose, is a couple of sprawls, because we want to get better at sprawling too. But there's not this beration to it. There's not this sense of denigration to it. It's just we're trying to get better here. So we got to hold ourselves to high standards.
Thanks. The gal you met in the finals is my kid's godmother and a dear friend of mine. Why do you think there's not I mean, it's she plus maybe one other person is, as a woman coaching a woman's team or a men's team, it's just not out there. What's that about?
I can't explain it in other countries. So I'm not as intimately involved with that. I guess first to say, you know, Jenny is doing a great job with that young China team. We've got a young team, USA. China has a young team. Lots of people I've heard in the last few weeks express great concern over the youth of these two teams and the fact that they can get a lot better over the course of the next few years. There are lots of other teams that are older and have some concerns. So she's doing a nice job with that group, and she did a nice job helping them come back hard at us. We won the first two sets. She made a couple of changes, changed the setter, brought in a different outside, and all of a sudden they're just doing something that we expected of course they would do, and that is counterpunch, come back at us hard, which was great. We want to play the best, being their best, to be the best ourselves. But on the women's side of coaching in this country, to me, it seems like one of the main routes to get to be a high-level coach. You know, I think we see lots and lots of female coaches in the high school ranks. We see far fewer of them in the college ranks. People like Christy Johnson Lynch at Iowa State and Mary Wise at Florida and Kathy George at Michigan State. And I'm not going to go naming all of them. I could name more. But we don't see that many because, in part, maybe the coaches have to work a little harder to make it easier for women to be able to have a family and coach. It's a really demanding job. And so, for example, and I might have this wrong, and I'm certainly open to being wrong on lots of things. I don't know everything. I never will know everything. But my understanding is that the trend is, if anything, to kind of allow college coaches bigger windows in which they can recruit, to allow them more contact. They can send more texts. They can send more emails. Well, that's just going directly against the coaches, in a sense. Why allow yourselves even more time of the year to coach? It means you're just going to be overworked and overburdened even more of the year instead of less, and making it even harder for a woman who wants to maybe have a family and coach too. It's a little of the same reason that the women on our USA team tend to have careers that don't last as long as careers on the very same men's team in the very same gym here in Anaheim at American Sports Center. When you're a female, there is a time in your career where you think, okay, I'm married, I want to start a family, I want to have some kids. And so lots of women think it's a one or the other, a binary decision. Either I'm going to have a child or I'm going to keep playing. They think you can't do both. So we've got to be better at making it possible for them to actually do both and not one or the other. And that way people could, if they chose to, they could play longer. But, you know, Clay Stanley's been with this program a long time. There are far fewer women who have long programs than long careers than men who have long careers in the USA side of things, because it's not as easy. It's never easy, but we've got to make it a little easier for women to be able to have a family and still pursue a competitive career.
Thanks for that. That appreciate it. And we've got 425,000 high school girls that play, and nearly 250,000 females in our junior program for sure. So yeah, we'd like to see some more of those people following in your footsteps, except on the feminine side. Congress.
I think it would be great. I think it would be, you know, I'm just all about trying to get the best coaches we can possibly get in this sport, and the sex of those coaches is irrelevant. Let's just get good people in this thing.
So people have asked about the rule changes ahead, and just, you know, you've been in the sport for many decades. What do you think might be happening? And it just happens to be that the Congress is meeting and the live stream is up starting tomorrow for those that might want to just peer into that governing body of the International Volleyball Federation, the FIVB. So do you have any thoughts about the upcoming possible rule changes or even longer range?
The only rule that I know, or the rumors are that it's very likely going to happen with this Congress, is the fact that, at least this is the rumor is leading me in this direction, that they're going to go back to calling all net violations. For several years, we've been playing with a rule, especially internationally, that the only nets that get called are not in the bottom tape, not in the actual webbing of the net, but only along the top tape, only that actually have an influence on the, quote, I guess, outcome of the play. So when the block forearms touch the net, or when there's an overpass and the person hitting it follows through into the top cord, the top tape of the net, those have been called. The rest haven't. I'm told that we're going to go back to the old rule, which is any touch, any contact with the net anywhere is going to go back to, is going to re-become a violation. Other than that, I think it's better if we don't make lots of rule changes. There was a time when it seemed like there were rule changes every year, and nobody knew what real volleyball was. Nobody knew what the rules of volleyball were, and they're different from place to place, different from high school to college, different from college to internationally. Certainly a huge difference. Internationally, lots of people are jealous, and probably and definitely rightly so, with our system. We have, I think you've stipulated the numbers, it's somewhere on the neighborhood of maybe 15,000 scholarships available for women to earn a college education and also play volleyball. And there are maybe 120 for men. But on the women's side, with those 15,000, if I have that number right, do I, John?
Yeah, about that many, huh?
Okay. I think I've heard you say that number before. I don't want to repeat something that's way off, but we'll call it around 15,000. So lots of people internationally are very jealous of the fact that we have lots and lots of numbers of people playing this game, huge numbers of people playing in college, which is great. The one downside, they don't necessarily get to it. Of course, there's a mixed bag with everything you look at, and the downside is that in college, they instead of making the substitution rules more stringent, more strict, having fewer of them, they expanded them back to where they were when everybody played sets to 30 points, even though now everybody plays to 25 points like they do internationally. So internationally, we're very restricted on substitutions. We only get six of them, and we only get to use them to, let's say, bring you into the game, John, and then take you out, and then that you're done and that position is done. No more subbing in that position, and we're left with just four more substitutions. But in college, they're allowed 15. So it's almost like, as I watched last night, went up to watch University of Washington play at the Galen Center against USC, and you can play with two different setters and two different opposites, and neither setter ever plays the front row, and neither opposite ever plays the back row. You just keep shuttling out these pairs of players. And that's great for the college game, and it's not so great for us because people are coming to us very unprepared for playing more of the whole game. We get middles in our gym who've not served competitively in years and years, because you can have a libero serve for a middle in college, but you cannot internationally. Or you can have a libero serve for one middle and use a substitution for the other middle. And then you never have your middle serving. And that doesn't really prepare middles for life after college volleyball. Or have setters who only play in the back row. That doesn't prepare them that well either, because they're not doing any blocking, not doing any play at the net, not running any of the two-hitter offense that needs to be run internationally. So those are some examples. There's a huge benefit in having the numbers we have, and a challenge, too, in terms of having different rules. So I'm not all that for making lots of radical rule changes. I like to keep the game pretty similar and let it settle for a while, let everybody know what the rules are before considering any radical new ones.
Thanks. This next picture is, the question I'd like to throw in here has come in from Alan Evans. How do you work to change players that have a fixed mindset to a growth mindset? Or do they all come in with a growth mindset?
They don't all. I guess it's easier to do in our gym than it is in anybody else's gym in the USA, because I just mentioned how many numbers of people there are out there. I guess I could... I guess it sounds pretty brutal, but we could just say, well, you're not willing to be a learner. We'll find somebody who is. We've got 10 other people waiting to try and be in this gym. That's not something we do as a threat, but we just know you've got to be getting better. Our good until this year has not been good enough, and we need it to be better. And the only way it's going to get better is by learning, improving, and applying ourselves to this constant path of continual mastery and continual learning.
So,
of course, there is, I guess, the implied threat, because we have new people join our gym regularly, and we got to keep performing at a higher and higher level. So, but we talk about it a lot, you know. We have times every day where it's okay to make mistakes, and that you should be making mistakes. If you're not, you're not learning fast enough. So we have these learning periods in every rehearsal where we get to go out and experiment with some stuff and do some stuff, and mistakes are completely okay. So we try to build it in and foster the learning process a lot. And we're still getting better at teaching and at setting up the right conditions to teach.
So Jeff asked,
we learned something just even in the middle of world championships. We were describing a situation where we might want, if there's a back row attack in the middle of the courts and it's faster, you would call it a bic. If it's slower, you would call it a pipe. And I think at one point we were, or for a good long time, we've been telling middles, I guess there are three main things they could do. They could just kind of get straight in front of the hitter and block straight up, straight over, or they could reach to their left or step to their left and block that way, or block to their right. And I forget the terminology we were using, but it was something like block straight, and that wasn't resonating with all of our blockers. So I think one of them just said, you know, I still don't quite get what you mean by that concept, and can you tell us an area to block? And so we changed it to, all right, well then for this hitter, we're going to block area 6. Just block the middle of area 6 when this hitter is hitting from the middle of the court in the back row. And so that was a little thing that we changed on our scouting report as a way to make it easier for the learner to learn, because it's not about us teaching, it's about them learning and retaining. And so a good question was asked and a change was made. Some learning was done.
Excellent. Well, you actually answer the question that came in as you went through that. So terrific. What's the best part about being a national team head coach?
I get to work with a group of coaches and staff, and most importantly, or just as importantly, at least as importantly, athletes who are dedicated to being their best, with the bigger purpose of making the program best. And so I'm really fortunate to get to work with highly motivated people and people who care a lot about what they do. Everybody has to care about it to get to this level. So I'm fortunate, for example, in not having to do what a college coach has to do and recruit. We're the only place people can go to be USA after they're done with college. We don't really need to go out recruiting people. They come to us, so we've got a tremendous luxury of getting already very highly motivated people who come in here.
Yeah.
We've made inquiries with some other over the last 5 years, 5-6 years, of people who were very good college players who showed potential to be productive members of the USA team. And, I've written emails to some people and they didn't write back. And I figured, okay, great. We both learned a little something. If you're not motivated enough to respond, then clearly this is not the place for you. So that's a good clarifying moment. Or if people write to me, but then when they start thinking more seriously about it, they're not sure it's right for them to take the risks that you take here, to put it on the line the way you do, to risk coming short and not making a roster or not making the travel team for this competition. It's not right for everybody. That's completely okay.
Yeah, Jamie is on his way back from Europe, I guess, or came in.
Yeah, he just walked in about an hour ago in the midst of this and waved to me. He's in and out of the office. It's great to see him. After the last time I saw him was probably about 10:30, 11 a.m., about 12 hours after we won in Italy, and my wife and her mom and I headed off for a couple of days of R&R south, and Jamie started touring around Europe. He and I both went to check in with lots of club coaches and athletes to say hello and pay our tributes and try to help set players up for successful college seasons.
So he said something a couple ABCA conventions ago that I thought fits what you were just saying. Surround yourself with smart people and let them do what they do.
And yep, and Jamie is one of them. We got lots of great, great people who, again, it's a blessing to be able to say to somebody like Marv Dunphy or David Hunt, hey, do you have some time to be able to help the USA program out? They care deeply about USA and what it means and representing and international competition, and so it's awesome to be able to have a program that is attractive to lots of people, so that if we are in a position to ask for some help, we get lots of respondents. Joe Trinzi, our technical coordinator, manages a volunteer program, and he just gets deluged with people sending in resumes and sending in expressing interest in coming here as a volunteer to help us. It could be shagging balls. It could be keeping score, but it's also some important work that Joe puts them on these projects of doing studies like what's a study we might do or have done. It might be, all right, if the server is in zone one and the passer is in zone one, so the serve is going cross court, is there any difference in that versus the server? Where do the most effective come? Are they coming from 1-1? Are they going cross court? Are they going down the line 1-5? Is it from 6-1? Is it from 5? And so he can, using all the thousands of codes and hundreds of matches that we have in the system, assign people some studies that are going to make us better. They can help us in lots of ways. And so it's awesome to have so many people who are willing to give their time to make this program great. We are very, very fortunate.
Well, the last set of questions that have come in, I've put into this area. Basically, I was just wondering if you've got time, if you can take a look at a couple of them and maybe answer them, and maybe you can answer them by written form and we can get them out to all the attendees as well, because I've got their emails.
Okay. I see this one.
Switching when back and forth.
Switches back and forth. I guess I wouldn't call it a switch between a 5-1 and a 6-2. Even though I know exactly what the question is driving at, but we are running a 5-1 offense. We're running a one-setter offense. It's not a two-setter offense. It just so happens that in certain situations, rather than having Alisha in left front and middle front and right front, while Kelly Murphy, our starting opposite, is in right back, middle back, and left back, we decide to make two substitutions and bring Nicole Fawcett in for Alisha. So now Nicole Fawcett, a hitter, comes in at left front for Alisha, the setter. And in right back, Courtney Thompson comes in for Kelly Murphy. Yeah. And so now we get to run a little more offense with three hitters involved, instead of with two hitters involved in the front row. What does that do for us? Well, it upgrades our serving. Courtney has one of the best serves on our team. It allows us to have a little more effective offense because we have three hitters. It allows us to get a little better defensive upgrade. Courtney is a good defender in the backcourt. And so we're looking for these minuscule, these small but tangible benefits. And that's why we did that. And it was a big benefit for us. Nicole Fawcett and Courtney Thompson were a huge, that double sub that we did was a huge part of our success. They both were very productive. Nicole Fawcett, I think we talked about it. We upgraded our serving. We went to a jump float. She was one of the ones who set aside her jump spin and went to a jump float, and she became one of our most effective servers, so much so that we would leave Nicole Fawcett in when she got to right back. We were playing without a setter, and Nicole Fawcett's serve was so good, we left her in to serve, but we brought Kelly Murphy back in the front for Courtney, back into Murphy's original position, and we were playing with two opposites and no setter when we were scoring points because Nicole was serving at a really high level. And then when her service turn was done, Alisha Glass would come back in and resume control of the offense. But that's why we did it. So I guess the second part of that question is, why don't you just start with it on a regular basis? Maybe the question is, why don't we start with Courtney Thompson and Nicole Fawcett on the court and Alisha Glass and Kelly Murphy off the court? Well, we don't do that because Alisha is our setter, our top setter, and Kelly Murphy is our top opposite.
Gotcha. How about the one down a little further? What skills should always be worked on in practice, especially at a younger age group? There's a lot of young coaches listening in.
We have to always spend time on serving. We have to always spend time on passing. And we've got to try to make those as game-like as possible. Lots of times you can't do it fully with transfer because if most game-like would be a server at the service line, five people on the court on her side of the net ready to block and defend, and then six people on the other side of the net ready to receive and run an offense. And so we just can't have lots of people standing around while somebody is serving and somebody else is passing, and there are 10 other bodies on the five on each side of the net on the court. So you can't always be perfect with that, but we have to spend a good chunk of time on serving, especially at younger age groups, because a team that is a good serving team has a massive advantage at younger and younger age levels. They can have a crazy amount of success without having any dominant hitters and blockers at the net, just a good hard serving team and people who play some good defense and recognize hinky. So we have to spend lots of time at those two skills, and we do every single day. And then we got to do some stuff that looks like volleyball. So that has a serve, and it has a pass, and a set, and a hit, and blockers. We try to have blockers involved as often as possible. We try to have hitters who are hitting on an open net with no blockers as little as possible, because hitters almost never get to hit against an open net in a tournament, in a competition. So those are some of the things.
Yeah. You know, we've had you for 2 hours. It's getting towards lunchtime for you. I can't thank you enough. I'm going to kind of let this stuff scroll. This is the Ralph Waldo Emerson quote about hard work and why versus how and principles over methods, and you've done a marvelous job of sharing information on all those principles that guide the women's team right now, and I really can't say enough. The last question that somebody had was, hey, how do you feel about Brazil? What do you think your chances are, and how can we help the team going into Brazil? As a youth tournament director, how do we help you, and how do we do things to develop the sport as we head towards Brazil?
Tell them some stories about USA. We have wonderful role models here. I've named lots of them, and I could name lots more. But those athletes should know about these role models on this team and their dedication to being the best they can be with the purpose of making the program great. So tell them about USA, quiz them about USA, show them video about USA, record USA matches and play them and watch, and have them aspire to be like that. Those are really inspirational. If they're in Southern California, come watch us train between May and September. Our training sessions are open to the public. Come here to Anaheim, to American Sports Center, and come watch. Also, that's the short term, and the long term is do whatever you can. You're still seeking success, but see if you can help your players be better all-around players, and don't pigeonhole. See if you can avoid pigeonholing them as a middle, as a 13-year-old, instead of having everybody set and everybody pass and everybody hit. The longer they can spend playing the whole game, the better off this program is going to be years and years down the line, and the better each of those players is going to be for any team they play for, a future club team, a college team, etc., when they get exposed to more of the whole game and become better all-around, better generalized players. So I guess those would be a couple of the things that I would throw out.
So I'm going to ask for one last story then. And that is the way you treated the two players, sometimes Olympians, who were up in the stands but not on the playing roster. Can you talk about how touching builds cohesion, how you made a very tight team for those 3 hard weeks? Because I thought that was fantastic.
It's not just 3 weeks, but I think you were scrolling past a quote I had that our success there is not based only on the six people who were on the court at any instant. There it is. Well, it's more than just the 12 we were allowed to suit up, and as it turns out, we traveled 14 to Italy, but only 12 could suit up. And often, but not always, the other two who were not suited up were Nicole Davis, our libero at the London Olympics and at the 2011 World Cup, and Kristen Hildebrand, an outside hitter for us. And that's not an easy position to be in, to not be allowed to be. It's almost like the rules ostracize them and put them into the stands. We don't want that to happen, but it does. So we were allowed to take 14 there and have 14 on our roster, but we were only allowed to have 12 wear a uniform any given day and be eligible to play. But before every game, I absolutely make it a habit to go over and look them in the eye and tell them let's go and give them a high five, a high 10, and say, here we go. We're in this together. So, and it's more than that. It's more than, as you see in this quote, the 50 who earned the right to travel. There's lots of people who weren't there. Actually, one time when I greeted our two non-suitors that night, we had another person sitting right with them. I think Christa Harmato won, or Christa Dietzen now, was not suiting up one time in Verona. And sitting next to her was Lauren Gibmeier, who is one of our middles, but did not earn the right to be one of the 14 who traveled. But she was sitting right there, and so it was awesome to get to greet her too. She was sitting in street clothes, and Christa and the other non-suitor were in sweats, and it was awesome to get to greet all three of them. And we have, you know, we had more than 50 people wear a USA uniform this year, and they all make a huge contribution to what we're about, because if we have lots of people in the gym who are not playing at a high level and not meeting or aspiring to meet the standards that we're at, then we're not going to be as nearly as good. And we need lots of people to be good for the six people on the floor at any one instant to be good through all the training. And so that is the reality of the situation. We'd love to have taken all 50 people to Italy and have us all together, even though still only six can be on the court at any given instant. But we'd love to have it acknowledge what a group effort it is, not just on the player side, but on the staff, on the coaching, on the staff side too.
Well, as a volley dork to our number one volley dork, thank you for taking 120 plus precious minutes of your life and sharing with us.
You're welcome, John, and we will stay in touch, and I will look forward to seeing you next week up at our USA Volleyball All Employee Retreat.
Yes, we'll see you next week. Appreciate it more than I can say. Thanks everybody. We'll be in touch.